Мне надо потом это закрыть окно, иначе там качество так себе. Вот. Видео. Okay, so today we look into Euclid's elements a bit further than we did last week. So last week we looked for definition of book one and postulates and axioms. Okay, and now we're going to look into problems and theorems of book first. Мне надо тогда скинуть какой зум или как? Да, у меня личный зум. Ну вот. Так, я его могу как-нибудь скинуть. А куда-нибудь можно, типа, быстрее, чтобы тут же Телеграм. Ну или давайте скину на ящик. Какой ящик?
Ну, сейчас. По-моему, там Святослав 4.
Давайте только, а то мы сейчас тоже время у нас пройдет, опять ничего не успеем. Святослав 4, вот этот ящик. Да, достаточно. Ну, понятно. Так, вот я послал, да, можете расшарить как-нибудь. Okay, so let's look further into the text. And so we start with preposition one, which is actually not a proposition. I mentioned that there is no mentioning of preposition in the original Greek text. So it is a problem. It's not a theorem, right? It's not a statement. And the problem is to construct equilateral, very simple. I don't think it's, how say, constitutes any difficulty. However, I won't really follow structure, how it's done, structure of a solution, if you like, right? So I'll probably write down on the, it's going to show. So we have several parts in this so-called proposition. First part, I actually give traditional names. This analysis of problems and theorems into parts is found in Proclus' commentary. But it's really, there is a longer tradition. So it's it was known that I'm kind of mentioning this thing much before Proclus. So it's just a source. And as you see also, it's very, very explicit. So it's kind of analysis, which indeed corresponds to pieces of this text, piece by piece. Okay, so first part actually is called preposition. I put it in English. There are Greek words. Well, I don't think it would serve a lot if I give you Greek words, right? Protases, if you like. There are traditional Latin translations, and there are English translations, which is actually all based on Latin. Okay, so first part called preposition, right? So in this technical sense, preposition is not the whole thing, but just this part. And what is preposition? To construct equilateral triangle given finite strength. As I stress, this is a problem. I don't think it should be read as a kind of demand or requiring to do this, because at least in English, like in Greek, infinitive doesn't have any imperative connotation, unlike Russian. In Russian, we have it. So we just a procedure which is supposed to be done. But you'll see there is based on postulates, right? And since this first number one in this whole 13 books, so it does refer to some earlier constructions, because further problems may also refer to earlier constructions, earlier theorems, but it also has something more, as you shall see. So we have a preposition given in this general form, right? Construct, render, and
sorry,
Да, если будет еще, так скажите мне, ладно? Ну, что... Окей. Слушайте, видно, ребята, что я на доске пишу, или не видно совсем?
Немножко видно, да.
Немножко видно. Ну ладно, я буду говорить еще словами, так что вы понятно. So that's called preposition, and you see it's given in general form. Now it's very interesting. Number two, we have so-called exposition. Exposition. What's a good expositio in Latin, and I forgot the Greek. Doesn't matter, and that's very interesting because probably I give you a third part and explain them together. So that's exposition, and number three called determination. Right. And exposition and determination are those. So expositions, let AB be given finite straight line, and next sentence is determination. So maybe I may ask you, as experienced mathematicians, what really happens in this, we'll just say second sentence and third sentence. What is done? What kind of logical speaking, even it, I don't know, it's not logical analysis in some narrow sense of logic. What do you think? Yeah, Pavel and Iskander, you may also participate. Yeah, I can hear you at least.
Okay, so first we introduce a finite straight line. So this is exposition. And the second sentence is the reduction of a problem to some other problem, to some
other problem. No,
no, exactly the same, but on a but a triangle on AB, not everywhere.
No, look, in this preposition, so if you like, formulation of the problem, right, it's just said that some straight line is given. And in this exposition, we are saying that the given line is AB. So we kind of give it a name, okay. Right? And in logic, I don't know if you studied or some deductive systems for predicate logic. And such operation is called in modern terms instantiation. By the way, in Russian, it doesn't have any standard translation, even idea is, I think, clear. It's Tantiation. Mm-hmm. Right? So in first we say, look, there are different ways to translate it into modern logical language, and there is none of it is really good and adequate. All right, so probably I will not much try, modern logical analysis, but just mention certain things like instantiations, right? And so it's no longer just some line, just some general term, but we point concrete individual, so to speak, right? EB. You may look instantiation. There are existential instantiation, general instantiation in logic. Okay, I will not explain this. I just given the idea, right? So in a sense, it's a part of solution. I think we would say today that only first sentence is a formulation of the problem. All the rest is a solution. Okay. Well, we can do that analysis as well, but here it's important to have all these steps, and there are many. There is more than the one. So we instantiate what is given in this exposition, right? And in number three, we kind of repeat the problem again, however, as applied to this chosen instance. I would formulate that with line AB. Okay. Now, number four, and this is the next sentence. Actually, here you see this analysis just goes sentence by sentence, very simple. It's not in all prepositions like this, but here it's very, very clear. So this is what is called construction, right? We are doing construction. Construction is easy, I think you all, except there is this long discussed issue that Euclid actually assumes that there is this intersection point C, and there is no postulate, no principle, which really allows him to do that, right? So you may say either this is a gap in his proof, in his construction, or it shouldn't be seen as a gap. So it's kind of intuitive thing that's all the way through. So it could be many said, but now I don't think they are very important and very relevant to my purpose. Anyway, we have this structure. So we have this general proposition, formulation of the problem, if you like. We have this data given in this instantiated form, right? Then the problem is reformulated in the instantiated form. And finally, we have this construction. No, there is no reference in Euclid. However, it's clear which principles are used here, right? Which principles? So we use postulate number three for circle, okay, twice. Then we get this intersection point, probably in a way which is not quite justified. And then we connect ACBC using postulate one. So, and that is the end of construction. But now tell me why it's not the end of the story. Right. So officially speaking, the problem is to construct triangle, and so we did. So why it's not the end of this? Yeah, that's interesting, right? That actually solution of the problem is not just a construction, but construction and a proof. And again, if you think it's not something very easily, formulated even in modern logical terms, why you need these two things here, construction and the proof. Right, so we have a construction, And we have we are using this postulate 3 twice, right? And postulate 1 also twice. Mm-hmm. Yes, exactly. And now we have a proof, and you see proof here is a actually in a narrower sense than just general sense of proof. And in Greek, actually, they had at least two different terms for proof. In Latin version would be something like demonstration and demonstration. Demonstration for just showing. In Greek, apodeitis, this was for proof, like demonstration, and something like deitis for just showing. Okay? And right, and what is the proof? And what kind of principles are used in this proof?
Transitivity?
For equality, no, there is no transitivity. So first of all, we use a definition of circle, which says that radii are equal, right? And then there is no transitivity. This is what we have. For equality, common notions, also called axioms, right? Now look, which of these? Fourth? About, no, fourth is about congruence.
Yeah, we have the CA equals to
we have C equal to AB and BC AB, right? Well, that's what you meant by transitivity, but it's not transitivity.
It's common notion one.
Common notion one, right? Not the fourth. Fourth is about congruence, and we don't use it here. There is no congruence, right? So there is this common notion number one, which helped us in a proof. So we have number five. We have proof. And number six, we have conclusion. That's also important because it shows where we are done, right? And in conclusion, you see, conclusion gives you also kind of formal way to distinguish the problems and theorems, because there is this last phrase, which is the very thing it was required to do, poiesai in Greek. And that means that was a theorem, right? And in theorem, it would say that was required to show, not by the way required to prove. You probably know this Latin, quoderat demonstrandum. No?
What do you know about
what this means in mathematics? But as a matter of fact, this is a wrong Latin translation of Euclid, kind of, because correct would be not demonstrated, but rather demonstrated or something. Okay, that's so far about problem. No, look, we may look at second problem. Did you look it up? It's interesting. To place a straight line equal to a given straight line at a given point. Do you understand what it is?
achieve somehow the straight line, so that one of its ends becomes the given point, but we may also rotate.
Right. So as I mentioned, this postulate number three does allow to transport given distance from one place to another place, as we usually do with the compass, right? And here, that second problem solves this problem. So basically, So in that second problem, you have a straight line given somewhere, you have a point, and then it's also interesting that it's problem somehow undetermined in a sense, right? It's has lot of solution because it's not said. So solution of this problem would be any segment point M, which is equal to AB. And that needs to be constructed also by Ruler and compass. There is funny construction which actually uses this first. One uses that triangle. Now you may look it up yourself, but now what I want to do is actually to look at the theorem. I mentioned, right, that there are two kinds of things, kind of units in Euclid. That was a problem, and now let's look for a theorem. Actually, in the beginning, number one is problem, number two is problem. I think it should be number five or something. If I remember correctly, so that is this problem. Number three is a problem, right? That is a theorem, and here, by the way, he uses congruence, but I bet it's a bit special. I will not discuss that, so I probably move to number five. And number five is a theorem about angles at the base of isosceles triangle, with which you are certainly familiar. No, by the way, you see here, he doesn't use any kind of symmetry, direct symmetry argument. However, he uses this last theorem number four. So there is this additional construction with additional triangles. Okay, probably I will not go this. That must be kind of elementary. You can easily follow it yourself. However, what I want to stress, what I think is interesting, it's again that kind of structure. And actually the fact that even if now we are dealing with the theorem, it's no longer a problem. And a priori, you may say, is something different, right? The problem is some sort of construction and theorem is a statement and you need to prove it. So how you have construction one end, you have a statement. However, it has exactly the same structure. Let's just follow. So we have we have this proposition, right, in this technical sense of part of this six element structure. So that's again general statement of the theorem for isosceles triangle. The angle at the base are equal. No, then actually there is a supplement. I may just stop here, not important. So he says these angles are equal and also adjacent angles are also equal, and there's a separate proof for it. Okay, so that's a proposition. Then we have the same kind of instantiation when he says, let's ABC is given triangle ABC, right? And then we such sides, and then such and such angles are equal. Already given by names. You see, again, by the way, about this thing, we may even ask kind of a puzzling question. We have this general theorem, right, which supposed to be valid for any isosceles triangle, but then we pick up one call it ABC, right? And we do all following reasoning with just one triangle, but then somehow we say it's valid for all triangles. But how, why it's valid for all triangles if we kind of check just with one? No, okay, think about this. No, roughly speaking, is the answer is that we choose this one arbitrarily, right? So it could be anyone else, and we don't use any assumption. Right. And today, in today's logic, is more or less captured this reasoning in this instantiation and generalization rules. There are four rules actually: existential instantiation, existential generalization, and universal instantiation, universal generalization. So first thing we do is existential instantiation, when we have here is our object, here is the thing, and when we generalize, this is a universal generalization, some kind of opposite procedure. Okay. Okay, so we instantiate the data, then we reformulate the statement of the theorem again in terms of these instances. So we have this item three, okay? And then, and that is probably the most interesting thing about this Euclidean theorem, that we also have construction, right? Even if you just read the theorem, why you need construction? You were not asked to do any construction, but we still do construction. And that's, as we would say, of course, a way to prove it, right? So we get a proof via construction. And only after that construction being done, and construction, again, you construct E, F, you choose F beyond B, right? And you choose G such as AF equal AG, and all that we can do already via earlier problems, this 1, 2, 3, okay? And then we have, so that's construction. Then we connect, so we have new triangles like AB, G and ACF, right? And then, okay, I will not repeat all this argument, which angles are angles, which triangles are equal, and you get it. So you see it's rather long, the proof itself. And finally, you have a conclusion where the statement repeats, and then you have this kind of end of proof, which is the way to think it was required to show Dxi, not upper Dxi. Okay. And as you see, we have the same structure, even if it's apparently something different. It's not a problem, it's a theorem. So it happens that in problems, we need proofs, because we not only construct stuff, right? But we should prove that what we construct is what we ask to construct, that what we want to construct, right? That's what happens in problems, and what happens in theorems, unless trivial cases, we need a construction, which in this context is often called auxiliary, вспомогательное построение, construction. So the same six-part reasoning. Actually, I don't know if maybe in some, if you study some type theory, functional programming, not yet. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there is a such a thing which called carry forward correspondence. And sometimes it's called Cary Horvath Lambeck or James Lambeck. I've never heard about that. And that's about correspondence. Well, in certain fragments, it may be isomorphism between fragment of natural deduction, deductive system on one hand, and simpler type lambda calculus on the other hand. And and also Cartesian categories, that's where lambda. And why it's interesting, because it leads in computer science, what computer scientists call preposition S-types paradigm, right? So the idea that preposition is a type. And otherwise a type may be not a preposition, but say a type of certain elements, like whatever, sets, for example, whatever have you. And in a sense, that resembles these things, you see? So you have, on the one hand, construction, geometrical construction, and preposition on the other hand. And reasoning with preposition or reasoning with construction, they're really kind of tied together and go in parallel. No, actually, there are many ways to develop this idea, and I think it's worth developing. That there is another, I forgot his first name, Melikhov, in Stiklov Institute in Moscow. He published some time ago several analyses of also this Greek construction. I looked a little bit differently. No, as I said, there is it's very natural, right? It seems just for school. But if you think about from a logical point of view, it's not trivial at all. There is nothing in modern logic which would fit exactly. So you would try to invent. Yeah, so anyway, I think it's worth mentioning and worth studying. And also, I don't think that that kind of scheme is completely outdated, right? When I talked to logicians, to people that say, okay, but that's, you know, ancient Greece, that's something that's very, very remote for today's, but I don't think so. I think even in my book, I tried to argue that kind of, you know, informal level, that kind of thing, it's widespread, say, in today mathematics. I took example from functional analysis, but it could be anything else, right? So you state something, then you say, let this be that, so you have kind of this exposition, then you do construction, do something, and then you give an argument. That's your proof. So it's very, however, kind of official foundation of mathematics, they simply don't work like this, right? They assume you have a proposition, and then you have some inference rules, and you infer some further proposition, and blah, blah, blah. And so there is no place in such reconstruction for all these structures, for constructions. On the one hand, of course, this constructive aspect of mathematics is very well, attract a lot of attention, at least many people worked on this. There is a lot of things done, kind of constructive analysis of logic. So it would be also probably unfair to say that it's kind of abandoned. No, it just for saying why Euclid is still interesting. No, okay, I think. Mm-hmm. I think we can move on. We can move on and just have a bit more global view on this whole book, what Euclid achieves there, and also on other books, okay? Actually, you did already look. Maybe you can tell me what was your impression. What was this say? Something like result of the first book. Well, of course, there are a lot of results, right? But what is kind of leading idea as you look at through it?
Some simple story geometry construction ending with the Pythagorean theorem.
Yeah, Pythagorean theorem comes. No. Concerning global structure, we will come to Pythagorean theorem. One interesting thing, interesting observation, is that Euclid postpones using fifth postulate about parallels as actually far as he can. No, in any case, sufficiently far, we may look. I think all of this does use fifth postulate, so it first comes. Yeah, that's very important theorem. Do you know? I think I mentioned it already. It's called, today it's called usually theorem about external angle of triangle. And this is a theorem of so-called absolute geometry. So it does not depend on fifth postulate. So it says in any given triangle, so we have this alpha, beta, gamma, and this complement delta. So delta is strictly bigger than alpha, and delta is strictly bigger than beta. And the same, of course, for all others.
Yeah. And that's what allowed him to prove existence of parallels.
Check this already, and yeah, in any triangle, the sum of two angles is less than two right angles. Yeah, that is also, this is also without fifth postulate. Mm-hmm. The greater side depends the greater angle. Uh-huh. Well, this is absolute geometry, and I think, yeah, 21. Yeah. Yeah, that's also important, you see, because it's not the only thing, but there is kind of theory of measurement of area, if you will. But as I mentioned already, right, he does have this idea of area as a number or something, as a measure, as a measurement. However, what he does, he solves problems of all proofs corresponding theorems. Of this, for example, to construct a rectangle equal to given triangle, equal as we would say in area, right? However, he does use this concept at all. And actually, by interpreting this common notion, axioms equal to equal, or if I add equal to equal, I get equal, right? And the, if add, means something like geometrical composition, concatenation of geometrical objects. That's what, if you like, is an analog of notion of area. But it's very different from ours, right? It's never. He doesn't think about this as a number. And of course, theoretical difficulties in a sense, reason why he does do that, right? That, of course, he is aware about this incommensurability problems, right? That not all areas can be expressed as a rational numbers of a unit, right? And that's why he does the theory purely geometrically, so to speak, without going to arithmetic. I come back to this, right? To construct a rectilinear angle equal to given a rectilinear angle. Ah, okay, that's technical. If two triangles have sides equal to sides, okay. So it's all about triangles. It's kind of geometry of triangles. Yes, I think that's first number 27. No, even this is without fifth postulate. If a straight line following makes alternate angle equal to one another, then they are parallel. So that's right on the pane of this external angle theorem, right? So this is again proved without fifth postulate. But however, if you want to converse and saying that if straight line intersects parallels, then there are equal angle. Here, first time, he needs fifth postulate. So you see he pushes his out until proposition 28, actually, which usually historian explained by the fact that he, Euclid, and many other mathematicians who contemporary mathematician who mentioned that explicitly, he had certain doubts about this postulate. And indeed, if you compare, right, it's kind of ugly in the sense that it's long, it's not so natural, and so on. So it does look like a good first principle. It's more like a hypothesis or probably theorem, something like, I don't know, Riemann hypothesis, right? You can use it as a even there is kind of mathematics which is done in assumption that Riemann hypothesis is true, then you can prove certain things. However, it does make it an axiom, right? Or at least in this traditional sense, and doesn't make pointless the idea that you should prove it after all. And the same with this fifth postulate, of course. All right. Yeah, so we have, I think beginning with, from number 32, he developed this kind of, which we may call in modern terms, theory of area. You see, he proves that this parallelogram, by the way, he never used this term, right? And he doesn't have definition of parallelogram. So there is this, gap between definitions and what he really uses, right? Right, so that's, for example, typical. Parallelograms which are on the same base and between the same parallels are equal to each other. Here, no, it's very simple, right? But you can see well how this theory of areas works in this whole nucleus. Yeah, and then so this line is developed, and by the way, Pythagorean theorem, in a sense, it's also about the same, right? Here you have more complicated things, which, by the way, you may interpret as algebraically as something having to do with algebraic equations, right? And that's important. That's kind of summarize the thing in a sense. 45, to construct a parallelogram equal to a given rectilinear figure. Rectilinear figure, it's a polygon. You see? So it's a step towards the task of squaring. So squaring, you heard probably about squaring in circle. So squaring is constructing of a square equal an area. And what actually, this is what he's concerned with.
You see, kind of.
Right. And here it's a partial solution, so it's not yet the square, but parallelogram. And in book two, he solved this problem and makes a square out of parallelogram. You've seen this, right? Okay. Right, and also we have here 47, this is Pythagorean theorem. And once again, you see it's not in this form which we usually learn about it first these days in school. It's about real squares. It's not about numbers. And so it says that these smaller squares together make bigger one. So what it means be together? No, actually it reduces to equicompositionality, right? So you can cut this two into pieces and reconstruct that one. However, it's not exactly it's not exactly what really happens, right? Because we have also this third common notion, which allows us not only to add certain things, right, but also cut them off. That's why, so roughly the proof is that you prove that these triangles are equal, like AB delta, or it should be, yeah, AB delta and BZ. H, probably it's eta Greek, A, sorry, B, Z, gamma. Right? These triangles are equal. Since they are equal, then the smaller square is equal actually to this rectangle, smaller rectangle, and bigger square equal to bigger rectangle. You see, it's rather rather easy. And the converse is also true. So he has, this is a Pythagorean theorem, and that should be converse. Huh? Yes, yes, and that is converse. Okay. No, let's look into book two. Well, perhaps you have some questions.
No, but can you think to me a bit more point was than book one? As they make some operations, some which are done within the algebraic. Way more easily algebraical. So book one was somehow meaningful, and book two is distributivity.
Yeah, yeah, I see. Exactly, I'm coming to that, exactly. So we have, yeah, thank you, it's the right question. So we have we have kind of technical definitions, they are not very essential, you can see. And then indeed, so the first says roughly that we put together several rectangles with one side fixed, we kind of construct a bigger rectangle. And indeed, it's looks like very suggestive to translate algebraically, right? So if you, this is A, this is B, this is C, and this is D, right? Roughly, it says that AB plus AC plus AD equals A C plus D. And assuming, of course, that product is a rectangle. right? And if you look next one, or even better, number four, right? That's familiar, I think it's in school textbooks, right? So it's about identity, about square over sum. So that's a square, b square, b square, b. Right. No, however, a good question is how it's relevant and in which sense it's relevant, algebra, right? There is no algebra in Euclid, you see, right? And then your question was why he does it in such a stupid way, why he wouldn't write in that way. Now, let me, before going to history, there are, of course, historical reasons, which, but even if we're not looking historical, but let's talk theoretical, mathematical reasons. Actually, the situation does seem very straightforward, because if I ask you, what justifies this? What justifies this? So that can be justified if you justify your algebra somehow, right? So you fix algebraic rule, right? Commutativity, whatever. And then you develop your calculus, and then you prove it. Okay, but what is justification of your basic algebraic rules? And moreover, no, if, for example, you may refer to arithmetics, right? And say that somehow justified as a truth of arithmetic, but even if you do that, there is no justification joining. So if it's justified for numbers, right, it does follow that it's justified for segments or something. Moreover, we do have situations where you have something similar. We are doing a big five in arithmetic and in geometry, which looks like proportion, right? Which looks similarly, but in fact are different because of the rationality and so forth. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that's for theoretical speaking. So I would say. But of course, the psychological answer to that question is historical, right? And in 19th century, when people first, that's wrong to say first, started to read Euclid seriously, that's wrong, but had this historical more than mathematical interest to teach. There were two brothers in 19th century in École Normale Supérieure in French, Jules and Paul Tanry. And I think that was Paul who actually put forward this idea. And actually, it's an old idea. He was not original in that, Euclid somehow he secretly knew about algebra, right? But exactly because he could not justify the idea of algebra because of this square root of two and so forth, he somehow deliberately translated this algebraic identities into geometrical language. However, I think it's absurd, historically speaking, and I think there is full consensus today. We just recently discussed that it's full absurd, it's not at all true. The truth is that they didn't have anything like algebra. Of course, algebra in this symbolic form, right, which we all know of school, it's invented in 17th century. And basically by a single person, René Descartes, and we are going, I hope to read his book, Geometry, the way he does it. So that was really a new invention, based on some earlier works, of course, but certainly Euclid didn't have anything of that. So you see, actually, in a sense, the opposite is true. So when people who kind of created the algebra, and that happened, it's difficult to say that it happened just one point of history, but actually, at least some people say that there was very influential person, that's the name, Khwarizmi at the Khwarizm at посмотрим, по-моему, сейчас это территория Узбекистана. Ну, вот это надо проверить, честно. So at least in Europe, and he lived, we check, and that I think it's 7th century AD. If you have Wikipedia, please check it. I think it's 7th. But I may, maybe 8th. I may mistake it. All right. And his writings were translated into Latin, were brought to Europe. So in a sense, he's an inventor of algebra. Yeah, and algebra is Arabic name for, roughly speaking, when we put, an equation, one term to the other side with different sign, it was called algebra. And by the way, his name, he also named for algorithm. Okay, just changed his name. But you see that sentence, I agree. Right? Yeah, thank you. but you see, that was like thousands, millennia later than lived Euclid. Yeah, so they, of course, when historians look at the different material, for example, they talk about solving Babylonians solving quadratic equations, right? And not quite unreasonable, but it's, so it's still a meta interpretation, very remote, right? So in theoretical sense, we may say Euclid doing kind of algebra. However, he was not aware of that. That's actually those proposition argument. Of course, if you take this position strong, then you should say, then you should somehow interpret why this proposition, why we use this. And I think there are certain answers. But anyway, what is true, right? And Altair is new. Of course, he knew Euclid. That's also true, right? So it was a whole history of translation into Arabic, of commentaries, and actually first translation to Latin in Europe. They were from Arabic. And over later, they made translation from Greek. So at a certain point, the most important development, I come to that maybe next week, talking about capitalism. So at a certain point, the most important developments in mathematics, they happened in the so-called Arabic, or better say Islamic world, because they were writing in Arabic language, like I'm speaking English, or I'm writing my paper in English. However, they were not originally Arabs. This, of course, I think it was Persian. And also, at least when I was teaching this stuff in Paris, and I have a lot of, again, so-called Arab students, they somehow didn't like the idea that I call them Arabic. At least I'm not this Persian. Okay, so in that sense, Altair is me who, before Descartes, right, introduced that kind of geometrical algebra using Euclid and using book two or proposition similar to book two. So it was Altair is me who roughly associated algebra to this geometrical construction. That historically, that we can see we have this text. And the symbolic way of doing this was again later, only in 17th century, again 1,000 years later, so much later, you see. So there is no reason actually to find anything like this in Newton. Except the connection of ideas is there, of course, right? But via as far as me and the kind. I think it's yeah, his measurement was published this year. Yeah, well, that's why I think it's interesting. If you just read it geometrically, in a sense, it's useful, algebraically. It's useful because it kind of allows you to understand what it's about easily. However, if you just reduce it to algebra, it's trivial and pointless, in a sense. However, what can be interesting is just to think about not in this non-standard way, no, non-standard for us, right? Purely geometrical way.
There is a question in the chat.
Sorry, I should go. Okay. It's not a question, it's a statement. Okay. Okay, let's look further. No, as I mentioned, these things are also, they are closely related actually to quadratic equation, and that's, well, that still leaves questions, of course, right? It gives you impression that he just knew about quadratic equation and put it in that form. However, as I just said, there is no historical evidence for anything like this. Right, and finally, indeed, he comes to this problem, construct a square equal to rectilinear figure. You see, so it's in a sense, next step after one he made in the end of book one, of squaring. And by the way, you know, I think it's a popular story and well known, but about squaring a circle. What happened with squaring a circle? You know? Who squared the circle?
Yeah, nobody.
Yeah.
Square a circle in
1775.
1775. What is it? This is the year when, as I found the first second, the problem of the square and the circle is because another problem. Maybe it was perception of an animal. I
don't know. I know that certain similar story about parallel postulate, but that was much later. That was 19th century. But about this, I didn't. And I also know that's a really proof of impossibility. That also was only 19th century. So that was based roughly. The law of the proof is the possibility. It's not very, very easy. It's even more challenging to prove, say, that pi stands in the number. That's a very, very difficult to prove. And, but that was done, I can't remember now the name. So, but that was based on Galois theorem, basically.
Yes. since 1775, the apparent
but so he did it before this proof possibility was obtained, because at that point there was no proof of the possibility of it. That's interesting. Yeah, but maybe it's just somehow was convinced. Right, so there are these three so-called great problems: trisection of angle, square in the circle, you know, the third, doubling the square. Oh, yeah, so doubling the square, we can double the cube. Yeah, and the only 19th century, we probably, by the way, that would be a nice topic for your final paper. There are a lot of interesting history, some of it literature. A friend of mine, he just published a book last year about square and circle, about law of mathematics. That mainstream is well known, but there are a lot of nuances, interesting points. Actually, I try to speculate in my dissertation that they. What they really wanted was not the square, a circle, but rather circle, a square. Because if you're just asking, if you're looking at these two first books, right, and what he does, it's actually, he solved this problem, how, which we just avoid, right, which is.
It's number three, which is here. How to construct a square equal to any polygon. And why he did it. So this is kind of strategic goal, right? There are a lot of things in those two books. However, that looks really like strategic goal. And if you're asking why. So in one sense, it's related to all stuff about measurement, right? So today we would interpret these results in terms of that's how he knew how to calculate area or this or that. However, I think it's also true, and that's my dissertation I try to justify by philosophical context, that this whole science is somehow based the idea that you have two primitive forms, something like, right? Circle and straight line, and circle. So in that sense, that makes sense, right? And square is something, oops, closer to circle in a sense. So the idea is that you have kind of reduce everything, not every polygon, not everything. To square, and if then you may also reduce square to circle, that would be kind of accomplish this program rather than the other way around. You see, no, that's perhaps a speculation anyway. That didn't work, so at least that's one interpretation, yeah. Okay, let's maybe I skip books three and four. They're interesting, but they're about mostly about circles inscribed and overscribed, superscribed. No, there are some funny theorems. One, for example, yeah, that one. It just says that that two circles cannot intersect more in two points. Yeah. Okay, well, it's an interesting argument. And that's, by the way, interesting case because they use so-called impossible construction. So if you prove certain things by reductor absurdum, right? And some of these reductors, they involve this impossible construction. So if you
that construction like this, which are impossible, right? And then comes to contradiction, but it's interesting that it's not only formal contradiction, like A and non-A, but also these impossible constructions which are involved. That's also an interesting topic. Okay, let's, I maybe skip this, because what is really important is a book five. And let's look into, and book five is something new. By the way, sometimes people, historians say these first four books, it's maybe some earlier source. No, anyway, within these 13 books, these first four is kind of separate block. And with book five, it's a new story that starts. And let's look into definitions of book five. No, that's important, but that's maybe not. Magnitude is a part when it measured the, so magnitude measures another magnitude, means that it fits, if repeated some whole number of times. So if you, a magnitude is not necessarily actually a straight line, it may be also say a figure. However, that is the easiest thing. I use this, so if we are given this and given that, and just one letter for the whole thing, and A measures B, it's a relation, right, which means that it fits, let's say, twice, or any other number of times, okay? So that's the first definition. It's called multiple. Yeah, and then it's very important, this definition of ratio, or in Greek it's logos. You see, it's very word which is means intellect, that means actually many things, you know probably. But technically in mathematics, logos means ratio. And that's why the way that things like rationality come out. And crucial is this number four. Yeah. Try to read it and tell me how do you understand it. Probably you came across it. Found a different name.
Multiply
means this procedure, this one. Then you apply some number of times. No. That's exactly applies to the case when they may not be rational. So that it's a purpose of the definition is actually treat the case when a ratio is not rational, so to speak, right? So next definition would introduce five, introduces actually this geometrical notion of ratio, which treats this irrational case. Okay, but what did you ever heard about Archimedes' axiom? I think that's how it's called today.
Probably heard about p-adic numbers, like non-Archimedean, no? Where this Archimedean axiom does not apply. So this is in form of definition, but what is today, after Archimedes, who uses it extensively, called Archimedean axiom. So it says the following. Look, think about like side of square and diagonal, okay? So they cannot be compared that way. None of it measured to the other one, and they don't have common measure. Okay. However, we should distinguish that case from case that's Euclid's example. Like you have an angle in the usual sense, and you have this kind of curvilinear angle of that sort. Right. So even if these are not measurable, there is that property that if you take D, the bigger one, and you take A twice, A, you exceed it. You see, you get 2A is bigger, strictly bigger than B. That's what you do. And so definition says that if this happens, right, for a pair of magnitude, then we say they have a ratio. Otherwise, like in that case, right, there is no ratio. So you cannot apply a lot of cases many times and get that. Or for example, you have a rectangle and you take just line like a side, right? Again, you cannot exceed it with the line in that sense. So line and rectangle do not have a ratio, but diagonal and side do have a ratio. Even this ratio is not arithmetical ratio. You see the point. And again, that's called today Archimedean axiom, and that's important. There are non-Archimedean fields and stuff like this. It's quite a popular area of research. So usually fields are Archimedean, like the usual arithmetic. However, you may also consider more Archimedean ones. There is a whole theory about such things. Okay, now let's look into five. So definition five, because it introduces the definition of how we deal with this ratio, how we deal with this irrational case. Magnitudes are said to be the same ratio, the first to the second, third to the fourth. Okay, so we have four magnitudes. But let me now use our little algebra, A, B, C, D, right? And I think I better write that. A to B equal to C to D. Right? And of course, you may have in mind some. So I have a square diagonal, A and B, and say I have a bigger square. When equal multiples of the first and the third, either both exceed, both equal to, or are both less than equal multiples of the second and the fourth, being taken in corresponding order according to any kind of multiplication, whatever. Can we decode that? Yes. So what we want to define is basically this, right?
A times B equals B.
No, we have the
there are no times, but we didn't times.
B is smaller than 2A, for example. At the same time.
Yeah, I think what he wants. Let's say M and N are just natural numbers, right? And so I use an expression like A times M, I repeat, and then it's this, that MA, say, bigger than NB. That implies that MC bigger than MD, right? And if MA is equal to NB, but that doesn't occur, say, when they're irrational. That's implied then. No, actually, I think it should imply it was good. Right? Okay. Let's see. And if A is smaller than B, yeah, so that's the definition. Fine. So that's how it is. Of course, algebra, you see, it's great. Of course, it allows to, just, to put it on in words is really difficult. Yeah, this theory actually belongs, that is pretty well established, to a mathematician who was much older than a couple generations older than Euclid, a contemporary of Plato, younger than Plato. Was you that's his name, and that's very sophisticated in a sense. You see, that's what replaces theory of measure of real numbers. Because, for example, what Archimedes does in this piece of parabola, if you look, his main result is this, that a parabola, by the way, it's for him, it's a conic section. It's nothing else, it's not an objective, it's a conic section. But the result is this, you have a parabola, and take two arbitrary points on this parabola, A and B, and we have this fragment of parabola, right? Then we can see the tangents in A, and tangent in B. Okay, then we go to C. And then his main note, there are actually a lot of results there. You see, it's not just straightforward in one theory. And it's very interesting. There is also kind of digression into mechanics where he weights parabolas. It's very, very interesting. But more demanding reading than that, I can say. And so this parabola is two-thirds of ABC. I even deliberately don't say not parabola, say square. This fragment of parabola is two-thirds of this triangle. And that's his main result, is not straightforward. You know, proof is rather involved, and you may also look as a kind of calculus. So you may try it, but this is like with the algebra, right? So you may try to interpret. There is indeed the kind of procedure there. And you can think about infinite series that approximating the area. However, it's officially, at least, it's not what he's doing, right? And officially, he uses exactly that, that's Eudoxus definition. Well, here it's easy because it's rational.
But anyway.
Yeah. Okay. And now book five of the elements is a theory of proportions, which is geometrical. Okay, it's a theory of geometrical proportions, and there are many properties, like for example, you may swap it and say if A to B is the same as C to D, then B to A is the same as C to D, etc. There are certain properties. Then in book six, there is application this to what we will call today kind of similarity, similar figures. Of course, you need that kind of theory for that. Now let's at least briefly look. Book seven, it's actually a different subject again. It's an arithmetical book. It's no longer geometry. We'll look now also into first definitions. But interestingly, that this theory of proportion, it kind of repeats. So there are propositions which look just as in book five, except the arithmetical. This is, so here it's geometrical, there it's arithmetical. And of course, it was noticed by Eudoxus that there is this kind of parallelism between arithmetical proportion and geometrical proportion. And that's that after all, and we'll come to that in weeks. It gave rise to algebra, actually, right? This idea that you have operations which you may do geometrically and arithmetically. And that's, of course, very new point of view. And we have some documents which say that that point of view was discussed in Euclid's time, but it is Euclid himself. He doesn't go that way, you see. He rather prefers to repeat theory separately, geometrical and separately arithmetical. And we find in Aristotle, well, Aristotle is older than Euclid, of course, right? So he could read Euclid, but he could read Euclid sources. So in Aristotle, we find kind of justification of this point of view, right? That if we have different subjects like arithmetic and geometry, and even if there are some similarities between them, we should still treat them separately, something like that. And at least this is what Euclid's doing. Well, let's very briefly look into this arithmetical definition, how he defines number. I think that's interesting. So here we have all that theory of proportion. This book six with similar figures. It's a lot of mathematics. Yeah, and that seventh. Yeah. Now let's just look at these first definitions. So first definition is that of unit or monad, as we call it today. Okay, and it's interesting that numbers for Euclid, talking modern terms, first of all, they are just natural numbers and doesn't consider anything like negative numbers or fractions, even if fractions were known, but Euclid just decided it's not an interesting subject, not important subject, but important are just numbers. And numbers begin with number two. So smallest number for him is two, because one is not a number, but kind of principle of number, if you like, right? It's in English, you may say a number of students, for example, right? And that would be by default more than one. It would be worthy by saying number of students, just referring to one person. So that's in that way Euclid. So he defined a unit, and that's more or less like definition of point. So it's a general philosophical definition. Is that according to which each existing thing is said be one? And number is defined in collection of units, basically. So it's something like maybe finite set. No. Probably then there are even, not even. And as I say, there is this whole theory of proportion. There is famous theorem that there is no biggest prime number, probably in Hedberg, isn't it? And it's well, so a lot of interesting stuff. We have no time for it. I only want the remaining minutes to show you also book 10. So we have book 7, 8, and 9, arithmetical books. Arithmetic, and 10 is actually the longest and the most difficult book in this whole set of 13 books. And that's actually connects, if you like, the two subjects, geometry and arithmetics. So officially it's said usually it's about irrationalities, except that he doesn't have anything like notion of irrational number. So in a sense, the strategy to separate geometry from arithmetic, one may say it fails, or otherwise one can say that that Euclid doesn't follow it consistently, because here we have this already notion of two magnitudes. Okay. Here he has this notion of two magnitudes having a ratio as a number to number. So after trying to separate these two issues, beginning from book 5 to book 10, he finally still finds them. Okay, I think we should stop here. And maybe next time look into Archimedes, and actually we should move on. Otherwise we'll never go out of this Greek mathematics. Thank you. Так.